Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Tonight we're going to use Google Cloud Run to deploy a Spring application that we create. And it's actually quite easy when we have logged into to Google Cloud and when we have set up a project right there. It is possible to use the gcloud console command, or it's also possible to use the UI console through a browser. We will do a bit of both in this video right here. Usually, I've earlier showed you how to use Heroku. It is not as easy as Heroku, but it is still quite easy. And we want some. The cool thing about Spring Cloud Run is that it is actually serverless. So we only provide a Docker image, and then this image will be spun up on a server somewhere, and then Google will then automatically increment the number of instances that are needed to handle the requests. Whenever the traffic increases, so it will automatically scale up and down. So it is very strong. We do not need to think about the servers. We can just focus on our code, and then we can deploy this Cloud Run service to Google Cloud Run. And then we just, of course, we need to pay for we need to pay for the users as usual. But it is quite easy. Let us look at how we can get an application up and running. Let me just check right here. Yes, and I will jump out to the left side today, like this. First of all, go to console.cloud.google.com, and of course you need to have a billing account, and you need to have an account, and then create a new project. I have created this project right here, which is called Spring Boot Cloud Run Demo 1. And I created that by pressing the plus button up here. It says new project right here. And after pressing that button, then I'm in this project right here. Then I can click this little burger menu right here. And then there's something called Cloud Run. Now I'm actually almost covering it, because I'm on the left side, but click the Cloud Run right here. Right now, we do not have any service, we do not have any application right here. That is because we need to, we could create one service through the UI console, which we will do. But first, we actually need to provide an image. We need to upload a Docker image to Google, so we can actually choose this Docker image to be the one that we want to run as our service. Before we can do that, the first thing we actually need to do is we need to install the Google the command line interface, the Google Cloud SDK, where we also get the command line interface as part of that. That means that we can write gcloud and then something like deploy or build. And it's quite easy. I'm using Linux, so I ran first. I actually used the curl command, this one right here. I'll just zoom in a bit. So I ran curl, and then I downloaded that tar file right there. Then I extracted the tar file with tar-xvf to some folder that I chose. Then I went in, and then I ran this install.sh, this install script right here. And what actually happened was, because I'm using OMC shell, so what actually happened was that I have this OMC shell file set shrc, this one file right here. You can actually see in the button it actually added some stuff right here. And let me just make sure that it comes up above my head right here. So this is the Google stuff right here. That means that every time I start a new console, then I can write gcloud and then something right here. And again, I'm going to minimize it a little bit. I'm going to place it over here instead. Like that. So that means I can write gcloud and minus help like this. And then I get some help. And then of course I can look at the documentation online also, and then I can find out that I can actually build stuff and I can deploy stuff also with the gcloud. The first thing I actually need to do is that I need to, we need to initialize also, of course. That's one thing, but we also need to log in. So I need to write gcloud, and I'll just go to my Spring Boot project right here. I have all the scripts that I ran there right here. So I have my login right here. So I ran gcloud auth login. And what actually happened when I did that was that then a browser page actually opened up, and then I had to log into my Google account. Then after doing that, then gCloud actually knows which account I'm on. Another thing I had to do was I had to set the project. So after I created the project right here, then I could set the project to Spring Boot Cloud Run Demo 1, which matches the project that I opened up right here. Spring Boot Cloud Run Demo 1. Spring Boot Cloud Run Demo 1. If you choose, you can also list the projects with some command right there. So, but after I chose that, that means that now when I have, if I have a terminal, then Google actually knows which project we are dealing with right here. I can also copy it so we can actually see this command in action right here. It's good to be in the So that is a way to set the project right here. Another thing is the build command. We need to have a Docker file, and this is very, very strong because that means that this video is about Spring Boot, but you can actually use the same principles for a Node application or for some application that contains, it could be a Vue application, it could be something else, right? It could be a Kato application that we're creating. As long as we create this Docker file ourselves, then we can actually deploy whatever we want and in whichever language we want to, or framework we want to use. That's totally up to us. I'm using Docker multi-stage build. I've created other videos about that, but what I'm doing is I'm using Alpine latest because that is a very small image. Then I install wget and tar. That is because I am installing my own custom Java, which is Sulu 15. I wanted to use that version right there, and then I create some symbolic links so I can compile Java code and so I can run Java. Then I create a new application called application. Then I copy all the stuff that I have in this workspace into the Docker image. Then I run, and then I use Gradle to run the version just so I can see that it actually works. Then I run clean build, and that means that then I'm actually building the application. Then I create another Docker image because this was just to build. I don't want to have the JDK sitting in the image where from I'm running my application. So that's why then I have Docker multi-stage build, and I've named this as builder. That means that I can refer to it in the second image right here, which is the image from where I'm running my application. First of all, I install wget tar curl again because I want the Java runtime environment right there. I'm also setting the work directory to my app right there. And then I'm copying from builder. This is where the magic happens. I know that my jar file will always be named app.jar. So that means that I can actually go and say copy from builder app.jar to this folder right here. That means that it will be copied to my app right there. And then I'm setting up a command like this. And because I have a command in my Docker file, then I do not need to give that to the Google Cloud Run afterwards, because we already have specified this in our Docker image. The reason why I always get app.jar is because in my build.gradle file, I have chosen that the archive name should always be app.jar like this. And that's actually it. So now I have a cool Docker file. And I can actually build whenever I want to by running this command right here. gcloud builds submit and -- tag. Here the tag, this is, we need to write gcr.io because that is the Google server. I think actually they have multiple servers, but this is one place where they have a registry. Then I need to use, this is my project name. This needs to be exactly the project name. Then I can actually choose something that I want myself here. This could be my live Spring app instead. So I can call it whatever I want in the end, and I can have multiple versions, and I can when I deploy a new version into production, I can actually say that I only want 10% of the traffic going to the new version, and then I can still route 90% of the traffic to the old version, and then I can scan the log for errors afterwards. So it is, I think this Cloud Run here, it looks awesome to say it. So let us run this command right here because I know it takes some time. So I'll go down in a terminal right here. Build submit -- tag. And what happens right now, it looks for the Docker file, fetching storage objects. Now it starts with the Docker, this is my Docker file running, and you can actually see that the commands, now it's downloading the JDK first. That was 251 megabyte. That is why we did not want to have that in the running Docker image. So this is JDK being extracted. So now it extracts the tarball. Extracting. Now it makes the symbolic links. That was quite fast. Now it's running Gradle W for wrapper. The Gradle wrapper, that means that it downloads the Gradle version if it was not there already. And it was not there already. The thing with Google Cloud is that it needs to be a stateless image that we are creating, it's stateless container, so we should not volume map anything out. If you want to save data, if you want to save files, use the cloud services. That could be Google, that could be Amazon, that could be Asia, doesn't matter. But use the cloud services to store your data. Do not rely on volume mappings. Per default, if you have not made any exports, then yeah, per default it will be port 8080 that will be mapped to port 80 regarding the service. So that means that if you have set up your application, your Spring Boot application, to use something else than port 8080, I'm not mentioning anything right here, so the default is 8080, then you need to tell Google that when you deploy the service. Right now it's compiling the JAR file, now it's assembling it, it's running the tests. Let us look at the code while it's still building, right? So I have an API REST controller right here and with some important info, and that goes on the endpoint API, important, and then it just returns a string, tra-la-la. In the meantime, we are now at the runtime image. So it is actually, it actually just created the runtime image. And now it is pushing the layers to Google. I'll show you another REST control. I made two REST controls. It's a quite simple project. I created this project by pressing File, New Project. I chose Spring Initializer, SDK 15. I ticked off Gradle, and I chose Java version 15 right here, next. And then I ticked off Lombok. I chose Spring Web like this, and no database or anything, next, finish. Then I ended up with this project right here. I also have a root mapping right here. That means that the root of the application, then I get Pong return plus the local daytime as a string. But we actually got a success right here. Now Google actually received this image right here. So that means that we can actually deploy the image. We can deploy the image in two ways. I could deploy it with a command like this, cloud run one live Spring app latest. Then all the default settings will just be set, or I could go through the UI. Let us go through the UI for the first time. So then we can actually see what is actually going on, and what we should give to the command line when we run that. So first of all, we are in Cloud Run right here, and I'll show you again where it is. Cloud Run. So if you go to the Google Cloud Platform, then there's Cloud Run. It's right there. Click that one. And then we need to create a new service. Create service right there. And then we choose where do we, I'm in Denmark, so I know there's a server in Finland. There's a hosting area in Finland. So I'm going to choose the region Finland. The service name, live Spring app demo one, like this, right? So this is the service name. This does not matter because this is not the one that we use. It does matter if you want to use Firebase. I will show you that in another video, how you can actually combine Cloud Run with Firebase. But for now, let's just have that. And then what we get here, deploy one revision from an existing image container. That is exactly what we want to do in this situation right here. But in a later video, I'll show you how to continuously deploy new revisions from a source repository. But that is not tonight. We will keep it simple in the first round. Now we just need to get up and running, right? Here we have it. And you can actually see here, I have some images that I've uploaded. One of them is the Live Spring app, which we just created 7 minutes ago. Or was it created in 7 minutes? What is, let me just check the other ones. Yeah, 10 hours ago, 2 days ago, etc., etc., etc. This is 7 minutes ago. Then I can select that. Then I need to choose some advanced settings, like which port should be used, port 8080. We could also have created an environment variable, which be the port. That is also a nice way to do it. The command line, the container command, we need to leave that empty because we already have that in our Docker file. But if you did not set that in the Docker file, or if you want to overwrite this command right here, then of course you will just set it in the container command right there. You can also add some container arguments, the service account. This, I guess this is the billing account, isn't it? So default compute service account. Yeah, yeah. That's so they get the money for their work. So if someone uses it, then they will get some money. This is a memory allocated 255 megabyte. That's okay. To begin with, number of CPUs allocated in the beginning, one CPU is fine. We want to keep to use as little resources as possible in the beginning, because then we pay as little as possible in the beginning. There's also auto scaling right here. Be careful with this: minimum number of instances and maximum number of instances. I would like it to be 3 as maximum number of instances, 1,000 instances. Then I would like to see what's going on, because I know this is a hello world or something like that service that I've created right here. So I don't like that it suddenly will spin up 1,000 instances. Let's say that 3 is maximum, but it will actually, it will see if it needs more. If it needs to perform better, then it will spin up automatically more instances. This is also very interesting right here. How can we trigger this service? Right now, we just wanted to do that without any authentication. We could also use something called Cloud IAM. I will dig into that and in another video. Right now, we will just leave it so everybody can actually reach our service. I'll press create. Now it creates our service. It is being created. As you can see here we have the image URL. That's the registry location of our image that is being deployed. We also have a, what else do we have? We have the service account. There should also be a URL somewhere. Auto scaling maximum 3. Where is the URL? I think it needs to be done before we can. Where is the URL? I think I need to go back actually, but it's still running. It needs to spin it up first. We can also watch the logs. Here we have the logs. Showing 0 messages. Default, yeah, here it comes. Here we get some logging. Let us see what happens right here. Create service, blah, blah, blah. It takes some time, but that's okay, because what could we talk about in the meantime? We could go to details. We could go to the YAML file. This is a YAML file of all the metadata about the service that we are just creating. So the cool thing here is we do not need to think about, and you can actually see that it's actually using Knative, Kubernetes native. That is what it's using beneath or behind the scenes. That's why it can actually automatically increment instances when the performance limits are reached. Traffic 100%. It is the latest revision. Yes, there's a lot of cool stuff here in this YAML file. And then we have some permissions. Yeah, we're not using permissions right now. Everybody can use the. I'm owner, of course. Oh, now it's done. Let us just look at revisions right here. Yes, now it's done. And what did I get right here? I got this, yeah, that was not the one I want. Let me just, yes, look here up in the top. What was that we got right there in the top? Now we have a URL. So if I copy that URL right there, if I copy the URL, and if I open a browser and I write slash in the end, then we actually have access to our service. Let us see what happens. And we can also follow the logs while we're doing that. I'll just press the logs right there. Pong, and then the date time exactly as we expected. I also got this API and then important. That was another endpoint that I created. And it just returns this important message, which is called tra-la-la. It's a good song. Feel free to sing that yourself at some point. And here we can actually see this is a Spring Boot log. So if there's anything wrong, we can easily click logs. So it's another way of thinking about our application. It's a service now. It's not a server that we need to go in and update some packages on or something like that. Now it's a service. We can just focus on the code, focus on the Docker image, and then yeah, then everything is taken care of by Google Cloud through the Knative API, which is running behind the scenes. This is the first video I want to create about the subject, because there is a lot of the cool things regarding this, because we can actually set our own custom domain if you want to. Instead of having that weird domain that I just had right there, then we can set up a custom domain. We can also set up a continuous integration pipeline. How do we do that? A continuous deployment pipeline. How do we do that? There's a lot of other things. There's a lot of other things that we can talk about. Register domain. You can actually go here, pay Google to register a new domain if you want to. We can also mix this with Firebase. That's another cool thing. If we have a Vue application as a client, as a front end, then we can say that we want to use this service as the back end. So that means that if whenever our Vue app targets and goes to slash API, for instance, and then something, then it would actually go and ask the Spring Boot application that we just created for the response. So we'll actually send the HTTP request to that service. That is possible. I'll show that in other videos. Here we have Google Cloud Cloud Domain APIs. Sometimes you will get a message like this where you need to press enable on some stuff. And I've also been through that when I went to the Google Cloud Run for the first time. I had to enable that API first in order for it to work. There was one thing more I would actually like to do. I would like to run this command right here, because this is a deployment command. So that means that we would like to deploy the same version again. You can see here now we get it in a terminal. How would you like to choose a platform? Anthos, we will go into that another day. But right now, fully managed, that's what I'll choose. And here you can see all the regions. And I would like to have Europe North. That is the Finnish one that is very close to me. Then I press 10. Allow unauthenticated invocations. Yes. Setting up stuff, and this means that we actually made a new revision of our service. And if I go look here, let me just go back to here. You can actually see now it's actually spinning up a new revision, and oh, it's actually not a service name. I forgot to, the service name is now my cool Spring app instead. So that means that I actually have two different services right now, which is cool. And they're both they look very much alike. So now I have two services running. If we go to revisions right here, if I press deploy once again, let me just do that. This is my cool app right here. Let me just show one thing. I want to deploy once again because I want to show that we can have multiple revisions and that we can actually route. We can choose how much traffic that you get each. Deploying, creating revisions. Let us check right here. Maybe I need to upload a new image actually before it works. Running traffic, blah, blah, blah. Let us go back here, revisions. Okay, it actually did not create a new revision. I think it's because I need to update the Docker image first. We don't have patience for that. That means that I need to build the Docker once again, maybe change the API a little bit, run this command right here. Then after that, we could deploy again. Then we would have two revisions when here, and then we can actually choose. Right now it says 100% traffic to one of them. Then we can actually choose that we will have like 10% traffic to one and 90% traffic to the other one. Thank you very much for watching our round this video off right now, because or else it will, first let me just click this one. Yes, of course. And thank you very much for watching, and feel free as usual to join my Discord channel or my Discord server. The link is in the description. Hope to see you again soon. Feel free to ask questions. Bye-bye.